And welcome to my topic, linking smallholder farmers to markets, role and relevance of farmer producer companies. Obviously, we all need food. Without food, we cannot survive. And how many of us are producing our own food? Maybe very few among us. Most of us are depending on some farmer, somebody else, to produce our food. But whether we are thinking about what is their situation, how much they are earning, whether they are able to maintain a standard of living similar to us. So I just thought of displaying results of a particular study conducted by Center for Studies on Development Societies. According to their survey, nationwide survey they have done, the farmers' response was more than 62% of farmers are ready to leave farming if they found any job in the city. And more than 37% of farmers don't want their children to become farmers because they already saw what is that situation of how they are living their life. So they don't want their children to become farmers. And for around 47% says their overall condition is not good. And around 18% reveals they are continuing farming only because of family pressure. They don't have any other source. So this is our farmer situation now. So how we can expect this can be continued, or how we can compel them to feed us by allowing them to be in that situation? So still we are looking at, if we are looking at the data, the largest share of our population is depending on this particular sector, agriculture. So if we are not considering much on this sector, surely we cannot claim our country is developing. And still we told they are not getting enough return from their farming, so surely they are not able to invest much on the next session. So they are getting very less, so they can invest only very less. So because of this less investment, their productivity is also very less, and again the cycle is continuing. They are again next session, they are investing very less, again less return, again less income. So other sectors where they are spending their money, maybe education, health, everything is coming down. So generation after generation, they are in this particular poverty trap. So if we are not breaking this trap, they cannot come out of this poverty-ridden situation, and we all are responsible for that. And there are a number of avenues. We are telling we are creating this much job in this sector, industry or real estate, whatever it is. But there are a number of studies they are showing GDP growth originating from agriculture sector is around twice more effective than any other sector in removing poverty. So surely all other sectors are important, but if we are neglecting the agriculture sector, surely we cannot eradicate this poverty. And we saw through last many decades, we saw a number of structural reforms, liberalization, globalization, all those things. But the advantage received by different sectors by these reforms, what they got. So we are looking at that agriculture sector, how much it got compared to other sectors. It is very less. So there again, that exclusion problem is coming. So they get this problem, farmers or those are related with this agriculture sector couldn't improve much on their economic activities. Then we are coming to the exact particular thing, smallholder agriculture or smallholder farmers. Then there is a classification, medium, small, large, and based on their land, how much area of operation is there. So marginal farmers, we are telling those who are cultivating less than 1 hectare area, and small farmers, 1 to 2.5 hectare area. So we are representing here those farmers. So surely that is more important because around 80% of farmers are coming in this small and marginal farmers. So if we are not representing this particular sector of farmers, small and marginal farmers, surely our agriculture sector is not going to develop. And past experiences in agriculture sector also, yearly every time we are seeing this much schemes are there, this much money is we are allocating. So whether it helped them. So each scheme we are looking at the advantage that is received by these farmers, the section of farmers. The small and marginal farmers are getting very less only. So most of the beneficiaries are large farmers, those who are having enough resources. So that is another issue to be addressed. Then why they are lagging behind? The main issue is small quantity available for sale. They have very less to sell. Because of the same reason, they have less bargaining power. Whatever the commission agent or the trader is telling the price, he is forced to sell at that price. Because if he is not selling, trader will be getting another farmer to get the particular product. So he is at the disposal of this particular trader. Then poor knowledge base, problems in access to credit, market, all those issues. Because he has very less resources, so all other platforms are not in advantage of this particular farmer. So that is the issue. Then intermediaries. So from the producer to consumer, when we are moving, a number of intermediaries are there in each step. So compared to a large farmer, there is more exploitation to be faced by a small farmer. So he has very low, small load, he has to take to a big market, so he can, it is the cost is very high for that particular small farmer compared to a large farmer. Like that in all the activities. Then scarcity of arable land, again that is another issue, the cultivable land, that is very less. And if we have to make available the cultivated land, One important issue is the irrigation. So for a small farmer, if he has to arrange everything for making it to a cultivable plant, the per hectare or per acre cost will be very high. So for that also, an individual farmer may not be able to spend that much amount. Then issue of reverse tenancy. Because of all these issues that we discussed earlier, there is a reverse tenancy is going on. Means the small farmers or smaller marginal farmers are not able to get enough return from their farming activities, so they are leaving this sector. So they are becoming landless laborers. The data we are checking, the number of small farmers are coming down and landless laborers are increasing. One inference we can make, maybe it is, they are leaving the farming and more are joining us landless laborers. So this land they are giving to the medium or large farmers. So such a reverse tendency is going on. So surely they are losing their assets. So that is not a good tendency. And how we can tackle these issues? So surely in this highly competent market economy, now a small resource poor farmer may not be able to compete with other old sectors or other forces. So only if we make a farmer collective, as a group only they will be able to sustain in this particular sector and can get a good return. So the answer was cooperatives. So it is not a new thing, cooperatives emerged to address all these issues. But we, if we look at a particular thing, whether it was successful, it was a very good concept. The share of their sharing, scale of economies, collective decision making is there, dissemination of knowledge and lower transaction costs, all these things because of they are clubbing or pooling all their resources and activities. So very less only the per head cost will be very less and they will be getting a bigger bargaining power because now they have pooled product. So they can bargain with the traders easily. All those things are there. So theoretically it was very good. But if we are looking at our experience in the past many years, there are a lot of cooperatives in almost all sectors in our country. But successful cooperatives are very less. Only a few sectors, maybe dairy, fertilizers, maybe sugar. Like there are a few sectors only showed successful cooperatives. In most of other sectors, cooperatives was a failure. And why it failed? The main issue was political interference because political parties thought if we are putting our person in that key position, we can get vote of or we can implement our agendas in that. It was one issue, then corruption. Those who are leading this cooperative, they also involved in corruption. Then allied capture, poor efficiency, declining government support. So the major issues why most of our cooperatives failed. Otherwise, theoretically, it was a sound system. Then another, the structure itself. It was supported by government and it was more focusing on the welfare issues. It was not much for profit making. It was just for welfare of the entire members of the particular society, not for making profit out of that. So that was another issue why it is not able to compete in this market economy in the current situation. Then now, in this particular situation, there is declining government support and competition emerging as a result of privatization and liberalization. The small and marginal farmers are becoming more and more vulnerable for all the competition and exclusion from the mainstream. So now this farmer collective has to be much more important or much more successful. So again, there is need for emergence of successful cooperatives. If these are not there, surely our small and marginal farmers will be much more getting exploited. So here comes emergence of producer companies. We told these cooperatives were not much successful in most of the sectors. So the producer companies came. Dr. Yogindar K. Alek, he proposed some amendments in the Companies Act, and this came the Producer Company Act. So this blends the unique qualities of both cooperatives and a private company. The cooperatives, we told, it was entirely for the welfare aspects, and private companies were entirely for profit making. So when we are blending the good qualities of both these, we are getting this producer company. So aims to provide both backward and forward linkage, mainly the input sector and output out there, marketing both things there. Then ensure smallholders can retain ownership of their resource and can get a better return from that. They are not losing their resources, but at the same time, they are able to get there. And then again, ensures producer sovereignty. Again, in the cooperatives, many cooperatives was took over by other traders or other groups or all those things. But in this, the structure itself, it was made that only the primary producers can become members of this producer company. Only they can purchase the shares of this producer company. So surely others cannot take over this producer company. So the producer sovereignty is there, and more legitimacy and credibility in the business environment. The cooperatives, when they are entering into the open market for business purpose, others are not considering it much as a profit making or a viable organization. They are not getting much credit there. But when we are making it a producer company, it is a competent organization. So it is getting legitimacy in the business environment. And along with individuals, not only individuals, any other groups, already existing groups also can make into a producer company. Then mitigate professional capability asymmetry between private companies and cooperatives. In the cooperatives, it was just a group of farmers, they are not much professionally qualified people who are not there, but in the producer company structure, there is option for hiring a well-qualified manager, and a CEO and a manager will be there. They will be looking after all the activities. So surely in a professional manner, all the things will be getting done. So there is professional legitimacy is there. Then strict disclosure and reporting. The cooperatives, many times these financial malpractices are happening. We are seeing a number of reports, but here strict auditing, reporting, everything is there. So it is more transparent, we can tell. So it is more credit worthiness is there, and much freedom from government control. In cooperative structure, many may be good or bad, involvement was there. So it was limiting the options available for cooperatives. But it was almost like a private company, so government don't have that much involvement, so that negative effects can be avoided. Then members' equity cannot be publicly traded. One issue was in thought, if the members, somebody is becoming member and they are selling the shares to somebody from outside. So it will be entirely from the entity of an outsider or the trader. So it can be avoided by including this, that the members cannot sell the shares outside. Only in between the members only the shares can be sold. These are the major difference between the earlier cooperatives and the new producer company. Earlier cooperatives were sold, registered in Cooperative Societies Act, but this is in Companies Act. And then professionals were not there in the cooperative societies, but in producer company surely there is professional management. And voting rights, one man will be having one vote. It is not depending on how many shares I am owning. If I am a one person, I will be having only one vote. Even if I am holding one share or 10,000 share, I will be having only one vote. And disclosure and auditing, like that, a number of advantages over the earlier cooperative society structure, it is there. Then government support, we told this structure is there. How much government is supporting? Through a number of schemes like National Vegetable Initiative for Urban Clusters or Integrated Development for Horticulture, like that, a number of schemes that government implemented. In all these schemes, there is provision for helping these producer cooperatives. If an individual farmer is coming, or the, if they are making a producer company and coming to avail the benefit of this scheme, government will be giving full support to them. And also there is another scheme launched by SFAs, Small Farmers Agribusiness Consortium. They are helping these producer companies. So they are providing some matching grants to these producer companies for their working. And also if the producer companies are taking loan from the banks, the, this particular organization will be standing as a guarantor for the banks. So banks will be ready to provide loans to them. Then evolution of producer company, there are mainly three stages. In the first stage, there will be just a particular development agency will be sponsoring a particular group of farmers, either for input purchasing or for marketing the things. So it is a small entity. The next stage, they will be making a retail alliance or some alliance with a corporate thing. So they will be working along with them, and slowly, slowly they will be making their own identity, their own professional brand. They will be coming as a separate production unit with separate identity, separate brand, and a separate platform. So in the third stage, a fully functional producer company will be emerging. So these are the stages of evolution, and simply, it is surely it is. So expected that it will be helping out small and marginal farmers by providing all the better platform for them. And professional management and technical know-how is there. It was lacking in the earlier structure. And they have their own identity, brand, everything. But if it has to be successful, there is need for government support and a good financial backup. Thank you.